Thank you.
Oh, you actually get it.
Welcome to session three, our third and final session on why do we avoid evangelism. And I'm going to summarize a couple things we've talked about that relate to this session. Not to repeat myself, even though I'm really good at saying the same thing over and over and over and over and over. So I'm trying to avoid that. But I've tried to share with you real stories from my life that demonstrate what I'm trying to do. And also, I can go use these stories with other people that aren't Christians. And so if someone asks me a question, I might say, well, I remember a conversation I had with someone, and this is how we talked about it. The reason that I've been trying to share stories with you isn't because you'll be more interested. I'm not trying to share stories so that you'll be less bored. I'm trying to share stories because somehow, the way we were made, stories connect us. It's not an accident that Jesus used parables to communicate some very important lessons of what it means to be a human. I can't help but think, and it really doesn't matter one way or the other, but I can't help but think that all of the parables are true stories. And when I started to think about it in that way, it made a lot of sense to me that all of these things could have really happened. And in a way, because God spoke it, it probably did happen. And that he pulled from real stories. This is my hypothesis. And shared that with. And so I said, I wondered, how much am I pulling real stories out of my life and sharing that with people? It's the last sacred thing we have in America, is your story. It's the one thing that will not be taken down and be told and argued with. And so if you've not thought about your story, and thought about your life and encounters with people and God, and are there ways to articulate that? And some of us are better articulating stories than others, but you can practice. You can tell someone, say, I think I have a story that would be valuable for others to hear, but I don't know how to tell it. And I run some stories by my wife and say, and she'll go, okay, no, you're taking too long. Or she'll go, oh, that was perfect. Because I have stories I want to share. I started to realize that I can experience God today and tell someone tomorrow about it in the form of a story. And that the story will connect us because there's a sacredness left. That we, if we still have this, if America hasn't taken it away yet, we need to use it. The Protestant world would call it your testimony. I'm not asking for a testimony. I'm not talking about your conversion experience. I'm talking about when was the last time you converted? When was the last time God did a paradigm shift in your life? And that you admit it's going to happen again. That's the difference in our stories. We've not arrived. Right? We have not finished the race yet. So this is not the end of my story. I will continue to experience God today, tomorrow, and so on. And those experiences are so valuable to others. We know this. We practice this partially. We love the lives of the saints. We love the story of how they interacted with God. But we think of it as like a we, they thing. We don't realize that we're supposed to be doing the same. We have stories, and they have stories. and that their story will help us. If we learn those stories, we can learn how to deal with these situations that we come up with. So stories are more than just a way to entertain someone. A story can reach someone. It can have an effect that you would have never imagined. When I talk about stories being one of the last sacred things left in America, there's been a turn towards science. And I love science. It's very refreshing, I think, when I get to tell someone, I love science and religion. Like, I don't think you have to pick one over the other. I think physics is amazing, I think philosophy is amazing, and I think God's amazing. Like, I can love all of it. So I talked this morning, you know, when I talked about light, I talked about that, you know, we don't really have a way to measure darkness, but we can measure light. The same is true of heat. We can measure heat, but we can't measure cold. Right? There's some science in there. And so some people think of the world in terms of the absence of light or the absence of the heat, and that if nothing's there, that nothing, that it diminishes. But we know that in some form or fashion that we really can't understand or comprehend right now, that sadly some people are going to reject God for all of eternity. And it will feel like they're nothing, but they will be there. There will be some measurement to their existence, even though it will feel like nothing. There's someone who wants you to believe that you can still have your personhood without light in your life, without a guide, without being in communion with your maker. There's a band I love following, Mumford & Sons. And one of their songs, if you've ever listened to them, and I'm going to quote the exact line because of how many times I've listened to the song. He says, "Awake, my soul, for you were made to meet your maker." And for me, I was like, wow, this guy's orthodox. Like, that's amazing. Like, he knows what he was made for. And we were made to be in communion with God. What we don't know is that we can actually, as we exit communion with God, we join communion with something else. And it's a very scary communion, this other communion. The world is trying to rip reality apart. And I know I say this over and over and over, but I cannot emphasize enough how important it is that we stay connected to what is real. And what is real is that your soul was made to meet its maker. And that every one of us was made that way. And that there's something out there trying to pull you away from. It's not just the absence of light. It's not just the absence of heat. It's an actual presence that is involved with your life. And if you leave yourself to your own devices, your own strength, your own moral code, you will fall prey to this other presence that's pulling on you, whispering in your ear, feeding you little lies that are very easy to believe. And we have to do everything we can to hold on to what reality is and help those around us do the same thing. Just as light overcomes darkness, the only thing that can drive out hate is love. Hate doesn't work. That's why I talked about politics in the last session. We saw a lot of hate met with hate over this last election season. I didn't see a lot of hate met with love. I saw people claiming it. I didn't see anybody doing it. Hopefully you did. I just know I did. But we know that's what our response should be. Society has turned things upside down to such an extent that when I talk about Jesus in public, it's easy to think I'm the crazy one. Because that's not normal. The normal thing is to not talk about God, not talk about religion, not talk about how my soul needs its maker. That's all crazy. The normal thing is to talk about other things. Once again, the world is trying to pull us away from reality. And we need to be there for the world to help them connect to it and see what really is going on. I don't know about you, but I don't really like to be ambushed. I don't like to be surprised about the, it's kind of scary. Like, you were in the dark and all of a sudden, bam, they hit you with something. And you really appreciate it when someone tries to use finesse and grace and wisdom in letting you know something. Because up to that point, you didn't know. And I wonder how much finesse and grace and wisdom we're using when we're letting people know you're living in a false reality. Because if we do it in a very jarring way, like an ambush, it can destroy the entire situation and drive them away from God, possibly forever. But if we use finesse and grace and wisdom, just as St. Paul did, then we begin to see how we are loving others as we want to be loved. In reality, you don't like secrets being kept from you. But you want them to be loving when they finally fess up and tell you something, right? That's how we share the gospel. We don't hide it, but we don't attack them with it, if that makes sense. There's a very specific way that you do that. Let me put it this way. If I have something to tell my mother, I don't talk to her the same way that I talk to my father. I don't change who I am. What I'm saying is if I have something very delicate and I know who they are and it's going to be difficult for them to hear, I try to think about what's going to be the best way for them to receive this. And my father and my mother are two different people. They just are. And so when you're talking to someone and you're trying to share the gospel, think about how you would want them to share the gospel with you if you were not a Christian. How often do we flip that scenario? Yes, I would want someone to tell me. But I wouldn't want them to ambush me. I wouldn't want them to just, take back the covers and then I can't see because I'm blinded. You can be blinded by reality if you're not acclimated to it, if you're not prepared for it. And we can do that for people. St. Paul did this. He did it by finding out what we had in common. And he also did it by telling his story. St. Paul regularly told his story, depending on who he was talking to. If he was talking to the Gentiles, like, I'm a Roman citizen. If he was talking to the Jews, it's, I'm a Jew. He was both. He wasn't lying. Do you see what I'm saying? He changed his finesse and grace and wisdom according to who he was talking to. But he was always honest. But he put finesse on it. And in his story would be about what they had in common. At Mars Hill, Areopagus, he found something they had in common. He talked about that. He went up to them and said, I see you have a dedication here to the unknown God. He said, I know about the unknown God, and I want to talk to you about the unknown God. He met them where they were. Instead of forcing them, St. Paul knew all about Christianity. He could have said anything, right? But he chose to talk about something they knew. which gave them, it was an entry point they could accept. And he did it with a story. Some people might get frustrated when you want to talk about these things because they've had a bad experience. What do you do when you meet someone who finally fesses up they were sexually abused by a priest as a child? You love them. You share in their suffering as much as they will let you. And you come to understand that there are people that have experienced things that we haven't experienced. Very severe pains. But how you treat them will affect them and their salvation. That if you get to a moment in someone's life where they're really willing to open up and tell you where the struggle is, you have been blessed with an amazing gift. Now you have to do the hard part and love them, no matter what. Just like St. Patrick did, that I said earlier. He loved them no matter what. He ministered to them no matter what. That was the first thing. And so when you get to that moment and you feel like it's an impasse, you feel like, I don't know how to overcome this. It's okay, you don't have to. God can do it through you. It will actually be God that overcomes it. You just have to be present. It's hard to share in somebody's pain, especially if you have something like what I talked about in terms of maybe it was someone who was sexually abused by a priest. Or who knows what the reason is. But there are very real reasons why people have turned away from God. I'm not saying I agree with the reason. What I'm saying is there's definitely a lot of pain. There's a lot of pain. And we need to figure out how to minister to them, pray for them, focus on how can we become better in this scenario, and be patient. That's all you have control over. But sometimes we feel like because we don't have control of the scenario, we just throw up our hands. There's a lot to do. There's a lot to do. I tell two types of stories when I'm talking with someone. And the more stories I learn, the better. And I think we should all learn how to tell two types of stories. The first story that is the one I talked about earlier in terms of God in your life. Moments that you really believe God worked in your life. Those are important stories. But maybe God hasn't always worked in your life in a way that's going to make sense to another person. Maybe you're talking to someone who's an alcoholic and you've never been an alcoholic. You need to learn the stories from the Bible and the stories of the saints and know how to say it in a way that a sixth grader is going to understand. If you can do that, you'll be amazed at how much you'll be able to share with people. And they will understand what you're trying to say. And so if I tell the story, say of the publican and the Pharisee, first of all, those are two words that most people in America don't know what they are, right? So we're talking about a corrupt government official, and we're talking about a religious zealot. They know what those are. And I talk about how they act. And I tell them, what we realize in our church is that most of us are really the corrupt government officials, and we just need to be honest and repent. But some of us like to pretend we're the religious zealots and that we're perfect. And they really get that story. Humility is actually appreciated by many Americans. They don't like dealing with someone who's arrogant, just like we don't. They like it, so we can communicate that. A year ago when I was here, I told you the story of Average Joe. I don't know how many of you remember Average Joe. And I talked about how Average Joe, all he had to do was just be obedient. And it was amazing all the things that happened in his life. But I told the story in a way that made sense to a sixth grader. Because when we're just quoting directly, there's no investment on our part. There has to be an investment. There has to be an interaction between me and that story. That when I'm telling you this story, you're picking up on how it affected me. Does that make sense? So if I tell you the story of how I met my wife, you'll feel how I met my wife. Because I'm connected to that story. And so find those lives of the saints, find those Bible stories that you really connect with and that you can tell help you transform. And when you repeat those stories, people will pick up on that. And it'll be interesting because they can tell that story transformed that person. I want to know more. If we're reviewing the practical ways for us to embrace evangelism and stop avoiding it, there's the givens, the prayer, the fasting, partaking of the liturgical church. There's the Bible stories that I just talked about. There's learning your own stories. Earlier I talked about asking more questions. The last two deal with the priest. First of all, I hope you're spending time with Father discerning your spiritual gift. That, remember, some of us are called to be teachers, some prophets, some evangelists, some administrators. And if you're not quite sure of what your gift is, your priest can probably help figure that out. And are you using that gift to glorify God? It doesn't mean you have to sell everything you own and move into a monastery. We live in the world, right? But he can help you discern that spiritual gift and use it to glorify God. The second part is that it's not his job to do evangelism the way we think of it in terms of the outside world. He's got a harder job. His job, I guarantee you, is harder. He has to train you to be ready and able, Orthodox Christians, to go out into the world. That's a big job. I remember the last time someone showed me the job description of a priest and then the average salary. They're like, most people would turn this down. They don't do it for the glory. They don't do it for the money. They do it because they want to serve. I believe that about your priest, that he wants to serve. And I believe if you work with him, he will help you become an Orthodox Christian that lets God's love flow through you to everyone around you at all times. This means that it's your job to find the people, not his job. This means that it's his job to pastor you and to show you the example, but then you're going to do it. He's going to show you. He's going to actually do it, and then you have to do it as well, right? He's not going to do it for you. One of my favorite things that my father-in-law says, he's a priest at my parish, he says he gets a lot of people come to me and say, how can I make this bad thing go away without having to change anything about myself? It's not going to happen. If you want to know how to embrace evangelism, embrace orthodoxy, it's going to involve a lot of change. Which is funny because there's a joke about orthodoxy. We don't change. We don't change our theology. But we are always changing ourselves, if that makes sense. We need to make sure that when we're remembering that we don't change, that we're talking about the theology and not ourselves. Because it's very easy to say, we don't change, so I'm not going to. I'm really good where I'm at. I'm in a good spot. I like where I sit on Sundays. I've got a good routine going. I'm content. And if you're content, you're not far from disaster. You're not far from things falling apart. So here's some good news. I hope I've not been too depressing. If you can get past that wall that most people have up of not wanting to connect, and behind the wall, they actually do want to connect with you. They're just scared. They've been hurt. They don't trust you. If you can get past this wall that takes a lot of work, you're going to be showing something they haven't seen before. We're blessed in America in a way that they don't know what we're talking about when we talk about Orthodox Christianity. We have a different set of problems. That's different than maybe, you know, a nation, some other nation that has a lot of Orthodox Christians that are falling away. They have a different environment they have to deal with. We're getting a first chance. They're having to deal with multiple impressions. We're doing the first impression. So you're the first impression of the Orthodox Church for most people you meet. I don't know if we realize that. Really, every day, you're the first impression. And if you're in a bad mood, they probably think we're all in a bad mood. If you're rude to them, they probably think we're all rude. If you cut them off in traffic with your Orthodoxy since 33 AD sticker, they're going to think that's normal. But if we start treating them differently, and they know that we're Orthodox Christians, they're going to say, there's something different about these people. There's something different about these Christians. We did that, actually, in Bowling Green, Kentucky. We ran a discussion ministry. We had several atheists come. And they basically said that there's something different about you guys. They said, verbatim, this is the first time we've had a conversation about Christianity with Christians instead of an argument. We have that opportunity as Orthodox Christians. So if you get past that wall, you have good news to share. Orthodoxy is good news. No matter what baggage they have from the previous Christian faith or other faith or atheism or agnosticism that they're struggling with, no matter what it is, once you get past that wall and you have some credibility, you have good news to share. And I hope you know that. That what you're imparting is joy and that it comes across that way. You're not imparting darkness. You're not imparting depression. You're not imparting anger. You're imparting joy and light and beauty and cleanliness and being healed. There's a lot of people that will agree with me that are not Christians that will say, we need to be healed. And I don't feel healed. And then I get to tell them, once I have credibility, I know where we can get medicine. And it's a different kind of medicine than you've ever seen. And everyone's treated like that equally in terms of needing this medicine. And nobody is off the medicine as long as they're here. We need this medicine. It's true medicine that heals us. So I opened up early on when I was talking about 80-20 Orthodoxy. And what we don't realize is in our churches, this presence that opened up this session that I talked about, that presence that's pulling you away from communion with your Maker, is present in your parish. It's present in your life. It's present in your ear. If you want to know the answer, and we're there finally, why do we avoid evangelism? I could have told you the answer early on, and it wouldn't have meant much. But now that I've shared all the struggles, all the pain, the suffering, the hard times, the mistakes I've made, the real reason we avoid evangelism is the same reason for the fall, and that's the devil. And that's the other name that makes some people nervous. People don't want to hear about the devil either. You know why? Because they think of Jesus. It's hard to think of the devil and not think of Jesus. So when we think about the devil, I want you to realize that it's a presence in your life. The devil is a person who wants to pull you away from God. And I think it's healthy when I can talk to someone about the darkness they're experiencing in their life and say, yes, you are being attacked. Yes, there is something out there that wants your life to be in ruins. But there's a stronger thing called God that wants to help. And so one of the conversations I had with someone who doesn't know how she feels about Christianity, she's not sure how she feels about Jesus, she cannot figure out what the Holy Spirit is. She said that's just the most confusing. But she knows that there are things in the paranormal world that whisper evil thoughts in our ears, and that some of those thoughts are not her own. How amazing is that? That I got to talk to her about what's happening and say, well, we have a perspective on that. We think that's real too. And there is an obsession in America right now with the paranormal. I said that earlier, angels and demons, the spirit world. We're obsessed with it too, just in a different way. Right? We need to understand that we are four-dimensional. We have our three-dimensional bodies, and then we have a spirit that's called to interact with God. But here's what we don't realize. If you're not interacting with God, then you are interacting with the devil. It just swings back and forth. That's where the passions come from. If you want to learn something that can help people around you and help yourself, learn about the passions. And when you start to talk about the passions with non-Christians, they have such an awareness of the passions because they're so alone. It's amazing. They know about these passions that mankind struggles with. They just don't know how to word it. They don't know how to put in words this struggle that seems to be present, but where did it come from? Why is it here? How do we deal with it? And when we get to tell them we have ways to deal with these passions that really work, and that can help everyone around you, you're doing evangelism again. You're doing what God wants you to do. So 20% of your parish is Orthodox on purpose. 80% is getting pulled away at all times. And we may not think about it this way, and sometimes it's kind of like, well, why did I get the short end of the stick? But if you're in the 20%, you now know it's your job to help grow that 20%. And that you're competing with a present darkness. But you have a way to compete with it. You have love. You have compassion. You have fasting. You have prayer, confession. You have everyone around you. You have Father. You have the church, the saints that have gone before you. You have angels, a cloud of witnesses. You're not alone. But you are called to do something. Does that make sense? It's a different kind of army. It's an unusual army. Because we're very serious about what we bring to the world. But we also want everyone to be healed. It's like an army of doctors with medicine. We're not going to force you to take it. But we're very serious that you're sick and we want to help. It's a big struggle when someone's sick and they don't want to take medicine. When I'm sick, I like to be left alone. Just leave me alone, let me lay in bed, wallow in my misery. And my wife likes me to take care of her. And I get kind of lazy and I don't want to. And then I always get convicted and realize that this is exactly how our marriage should work. That I should let her take care of me when I'm sick. Don't tell her to go away. And that I should be anxious to take care of her when she's sick. Right? We have a lot of sick people around us who don't want the medicine. You still need to minister to them. And through you ministering to them, eventually, there's a decent chance they will want to try the medicine out. But God wants you to work on giving them the medicine. That's our role in society. And that sometimes we need the medicine when we think we're doing okay. That's why we go to confession often, because we need some medicine. That's why we take the Eucharist every Sunday, because we need the medicine. But it's very easy for us to think that we're doing okay when we're not. So in closing, let's review. I'm going to finish a little early if that's okay for questions, because we've talked about a lot. So, and I actually could keep talking all day, so I don't want to do that. But I want to review the definition that I hope you understand, that it involves community, involves God working through me to you, through you to me, that it's always present. Evangelism is not a compartment in your life. It's the way you talk to people. It's the way you treat people. That orthodoxy is evangelism. And that how we communicate God's love to everyone matters. That you have a lot to do with it. And at the end of the day, I'll finish with this story, because this is hard for some of us. I talked about early on, we want people to care about the things we care about. Right? If I love a TV show and you don't love a TV show, I think there's something wrong with you. If I love this book and you don't love this book, I worry about your sanity. I want you to care about what I care about. That's not going to happen often with Christianity the way you want it to. It will happen. But you have to be open to it happening in a different way. And so, what we need to remember is at the end of the day, there still could be rejection. At the end of the day, the wall might never come down. Right? At the end of the day, they might still hate God or not believe in God. Day after day after day. Your job is to acquire the Holy Spirit the way St. Patrick did, day after day after day. We do the first four no matter what. Number five was how St. Patrick respected everyone's free will. America is very serious about its free will. Even Southerners, we're even more serious about our free will. We love free will. We don't understand how you can have free will and bad things happen to good people at the same time, but we're not giving up our free will. So at the end of the day, you have to be okay with whatever end result happens with this people in your lives. That's not why you're doing it. Does that make sense? You're not doing it to make your list of names. Like my friend. You're doing it to make the list of people that you've loved. So, that's the end of my session. It's the end of my talks. Like I said, there's a lot more, but I didn't want to cause any of you to fall asleep. So, it doesn't have to be Q&A if you just have comments or thoughts, but I really hope some of you will talk, because I love dialogue. I love dialogue. So, any thoughts? Yes?
One of the things that is challenging for me is when there are some of these controversial topics, pick anyone you want, I'm not always sure I have the right answer. Not that there could be a single right answer, but I'm not really sure I'm representing the church when I say something, because there isn't like a little booklet says, what do you say when XYZ, right? So, how do you actually get to the point should we have a class here? Because that happens all the time to me.
Don't ask me.
I've had this exact
conversation. I don't have all day. Yes, sir.
So I've had this exact conversation with my son. And my son doesn't like my answer. And a lot of people don't like my answer. But I really feel like my answer is, it's hard to disagree with. Even if you don't like it, it's really hard to disagree with. You need to read more and be intentional about what you're reading. And what you're reading came from a person. It's okay to explore help on dealing with these topics. And so, one of the people that helped me in the beginning of dealing with this, that's been heavily influenced, obviously, by patristics and the church fathers, but, you know, I wasn't even reading it for this purpose, but, for example, when I read Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis, he framed things in a way that I hadn't thought about. And really helped me begin to have these discussions on the purpose of marriage. And that's where I started with the purpose of marriage. I didn't finish there with C.S. Lewis, but he had a really great thing to say about that started there and eventually got me the point where I could talk with someone and say, we're not talking about the same thing. And I can say it with confidence. I know that we're not talking about the same thing. And so you really do need to be well-read. You don't have to be smart. You don't have to read intense theological books. We let Father do that. He loves it. You know, but there's some theological books I have a hard time getting through, and then there's others that I feel like I read it so quickly, I'm like, how did I do that? I don't know. And so I'm always trying to read something. And my son didn't like that answer, because we were talking about something, and I said, you need to read more. And he was like, I don't want to read more. And this is a big struggle I'm having with my kids. And I bribe my kids to read. I no qualms about that. I pay them for a book report. I will do it all day long for the rest of my life. I don't care if they're 50 years old. I'll pay them for a book report.
How old is your son that you're debating with?
How old is my son? Yeah. He's 12 right now.
Oh, boy. Okay.
But when I look back at everything I've read and how much it's helped me, there's things that you get in books that you will never get from the news, that you will never get from YouTube, that you will never get from Time.
YouTube has everything.
You know what else is a book that's amazing? The Bible. We're not reading enough. You know who told us that we should know the scriptures? We should know them. St. John Chrysostom. And I'm not doing a really good job. I'm trying. But I don't mind admitting, like, if somebody starts quoting something, I'll be like, whew, you know, you move past me there. But I try to read as much as possible. And we're just a society moving away from reading. But the more you read, the more you informed, and the more that you will be able to think through these issues that you're talking about. Yeah,
I
know what that's like.
That's what I call Father. What did this really mean?
Yeah.
Didn't that have you scared?
Did they just contradict each other? But I think it would be beneficial, though, to have some way to, I think, help us as a community here even to talk about some of these things. And maybe we do our own class or our own discussion group.
Probably.
You know, we'll just start thinking about, well, Father, here are the five things that, you know.
I can send you the seven most difficult struggles with Christianity.
Yeah.
If you want to see those, I can send those to you.
That would be really interesting.
Are they YouTube videos?
Yeah, they're not YouTube videos.
They get scammed. You're going to carry them out.
Not longer than 3 minutes, is it?
I would love that.
Yeah, each one is 3 hours.
I usually end up saying, here's my understanding of what the church
I think that's appropriate, though, no matter how great you're saying it.
And I even say, sometimes, I don't know, but I'm happy to research a little bit.
Yeah.
And depending on the, you can't always do that though.
Yeah.
Depending on the person.
But I'll send you that list, and then you can start to see what it is we're dealing with in a quantifiable way. Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts? Do you have anybody trained in addictions?
Yeah.
I have a lot of addictions.
We have one person.
You have one person? That would be very valuable, probably, to have them help. And this is something that will creep up in many of our lives, some form of addiction by a friend or family member. And how do we talk to them? Do we say anything? Do we not say anything? You know, so, and if you're... You know, I'm learning a little bit more about Prescott and the addictions community. That's a valuable conversation to have when that's your demographic. So absolutely. You know, I know of a parish that's surrounded by, it's in the middle of a Spanish-speaking neighborhood, and nobody there speaks Spanish. I'm like, well, any of you trying to learn? It's the same thing. You want to learn the lingo. How do we talk? So if you were in the, you know, what's your demographic? That's, you need to learn how to talk to them. So that's, I think that's right in line with, you know, the spirit of evangelism we're trying to do. Any other thoughts?
It kind of goes along with what Gina was just saying, but it's about reducing very complex topics and subjects that, you know, like the mysteries of the church, they can't really be reduced to like a 5-minute conversation or a soundbite or something like that if you're talking to someone who has no clue, or if you're talking to someone who has a different perspective. Like a Muslim says to a Christian, you're a polytheist. You believe in three gods. You worship three gods. We are the only monotheistic religion. How do you explain the Trinity in like two sentences to someone who's got that view?
And that's something that becomes really challenging because to a certain extent, I think frequently it'll depend on the conversation itself and who you're talking with. So is the person coming at you as a fundamentalist that's trying to sort of, like Adam was talking about earlier, how we don't want to like approach people and
right.
try to stab them
exactly.
with what we believe.
Mm-hmm.
And so if somebody's doing that to you, it becomes a situation like Christ describes in the Gospels where he says, don't throw your pearls before swine.
Uh-huh.
You know, and so you're not going to want to spend time trying to explain the Trinity when somebody's coming up to you, you know, saying all this stuff. And, because it would be a waste of time.
Exactly.
You know, and and so for instance, in the early church, you know, it's pretty clear that people weren't taught the creed, you know, outside of the Christian community. And until they had become, you know, they were well along in their catechesis and just about to be baptized, you know. And, but what they did talk with people about was the things that Adam was mentioning earlier, the struggle with your passions, the need to turn away from sin. You know what I mean? The fact that every single human being seems destined only to die and disappear forever. You know, and stuff like that. And so where is the freedom from that? Where is deliverance from that? You know, where is genuine freedom? And so they talk with people about those things, you know. And rather than trying to get into, like, essentially, like you were saying, the things that are the mysteries of our faith that are really way beyond comprehension and have much more to do with, St. Max is the term we use with mystagogy, or being initiated into understanding. You know, and so it's not something you just come by, you know.
I can't can't remember off the top of my head, and I hopefully you'll remember the rest of it, Father, but I do know one of the things we should try to avoid is oversimplification of orthodoxy.
Yeah.
That you run the risk of heresy, of communicating it the wrong way. And that's why there's so much written on orthodoxy, because they...
So, a good example of that is the push. I mean, we do this in our advertising, you know, the mailers we're sending out and stuff like that, but the overemphasis on the church being ancient and unchanging. And so, like you just talked about, but we're changing all the time, you know, even though the faith stays the same. And then there's the other aspect. The recent Council in Crete, they were really clear. They were like, it's arbitrary and unjust to characterize the church primarily as conservative. You know, and people look at the church that way, but they're like, that's an arbitrary and unjust classification of what orthodoxy is, what the Orthodox Church is. And so we have to pay attention to that. But, like, sometimes we try and say these things about who we are, mm-hmm. and because we oversimplify, we can end up saying things that aren't really true.
But then I think that's why people can't really defend the faith, because they're afraid to say anything because they might be wrong, or it might be heresy, or it might be off.
Yeah.
Because it's so complex.
Which goes back to...
you're sort of standing there like,
which goes back to that we need to talk about.
No, that's not what we believe. Can I get out of here right away? Because I don't want to talk to you anymore. You know? I mean, that's sort of the challenge.
That's why I try not to reduce it down to argumentative points, talking points. It's not about talking points. I do have casual encounters where we might have a conversation about God. But talking points are not how I think of it. I think of it in this is really how I understand it. This is really how I understand the purpose of marriage. I started studying the purpose of marriage when same-sex marriage was legalized in 2015. I said, okay, I need to know how to talk about this. And so I spent time learning how to talk about it. It didn't just happen overnight. And so that's why I don't want you to think this is not... These are very real issues, very present, have been written about extensively by many great Christians. And so I said, I need to know what's been said. And so the beginning of that journey for me was C.S. Lewis. It wasn't the end, but I'm okay with that being the beginning. I like some of the things he says. So, but his idea, which was not a new idea, it was just the first time I had heard someone say it in a modern way, was help, if you're having these discussions, make sure you're having the discussion about the real issue, not the symptoms of the issue. Does that make sense? And so that's why I was saying, when a woman, so if you get asked about, do you believe in a, you know, you believe in a polytheistic God, because it's Trinitarian, and, you know, this other guy's Muslim, so he believes in a monotheistic God. That might not really be the conversation that should be had between you two, even though that's what came up. And so it's kind of hard for me to role play without being there. You know, I hate to say that, but I do know.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
But it makes me think when we were at the bar last night, and the bartender comes over, and I was stuffing my cat suit. And
dancing on the table.
And so, yeah. But then we had been talking, and then he came over and sat down with us, and wanted to start talking, and he starts sharing all this stuff. You know, we said, what's your background? And he said, well, you know, actually, I think he literally said he was spiritual but not religious.
Yes, he literally said it.
Literally said it. Yeah. But then he started going into, like, all of his theories about, like, where does the world come from and all this other stuff, you know. And Adam was asking him some kind of, sort of, like, leading questions to get him, you know. But it was fascinating. And so sometimes if you just let people talk for a while, because I could already start to see ways that I could continue the conversation with this guy. started talking about the human person, the human being, and having spirit, and he believes in reincarnation, but one of the things that he was trying to say is he's trying to make, you know, humanity like really distinct from the rest of creation. Like there's something like semi-divine about human beings. Well, it's like, well, but you're a person. You believe that you matter, right? You know, that you're important. And so why reincarnation? You know what I mean? Like, why is your existence right now just a mask that being has to like slough off and throw away? And like, how do you? Because you could already sense that in his what he was saying that he really values people, you know. And so then, well, according with the notion of reincarnation, but they don't really matter, you know. And like the whole idea that the individual matters, it's like that's not. You can't fit that with reincarnation and make it rationally make sense, you know. And but that's the whole thing. You know, he was just wanting to, like, lay his whole thing on us, you know, and that's fine. So it's like, let him talk. You know?
Yeah, he did most of the talking. He did most of the talking, and I was okay with that, because I know that there was a seed planted of some guys willing to sit and listen, and that when you guys go back, he might listen to you guys.
And
you have some stuff in common. And even I wasn't thinking it at first, but when you said it, I was like, oh wow, he laid out how he believes the world came to be, and it almost fits within Orthodox.
Oh yeah,
it was weird.
Yeah.
Like
I was talking with Ty about that. It's
yeah,
like, it's sort of like G.K. Chesterton. I think in his book Orthodox, he talks about which he became Roman Catholic, but he talks about how he set out as a liberal humanist to create his own heresy that would be like the best way of being in the world, and he realized that he had created Christianity by accident. You know, so then he said, "Oh, I give up. I'm just gonna, you know, become a Christian."
So yeah, when this guy came up with his own theory of how it was, it matched the way we understand creation, which was bizarre.
Something I thought of, Helen, when you gave your example, though, too. I mean, I think I still am naive in a lot of ways, but I think when we were slowly becoming Orthodox, we spent hours and hours and hours of Orthodox people asking sincere questions, not because we knew we wanted to be Orthodox, I mean, that came later, but we were just genuinely curious. So we were asking the hard questions, like, wait, what is this about Mary? And the people we were asking were gracious and spent, seriously, like 4 hours after church every Sunday just answering our questions. And so I kind of assumed, once I became Orthodox, that as people would come to me and ask questions, I always naively assumed that they were genuinely curious. But then I found a lot of them were coming with a chip on their shoulder. And I think something Adam said, which is something we all know, but it was a good reminder, is just like being loving. And you don't have to, those people, I don't feel like you necessarily have to defend the faith to, because they're just looking for an argument or an attack. And so I don't know, that's something that's been helpful to me, is just kind of assess the situation, like what is, and there's going to be those, yeah, like you said, like airplane ride conversations or whatever, that you are going to have some answers for, maybe, but for the most part, I think someone who's genuinely curious is going to take the time to listen and ask questions, and I don't know if that makes sense. Well,
but even if they do come at you hostily, like we did last night, like letting some people just, sometimes the best love you can give them is just to hear them.
Mm-hmm.
Just listen, let them be angry, let them be, dump all their burdens of faith and why they think you're wrong on the table, and be okay with it. Like,
they'll hear themselves.
So they're looking for the reaction, for the battle. You know, that's what the family diagram, you look for the battle. But when I took the battle away, it created more genuine, okay, well, tell me about that. Because they realized it wasn't going to get a rise, it wasn't going to get that. It became truly a
experience for them to be listened to. They're so used to being bad, they don't even know what it's like to be listened to.
Yeah, they don't know. That's what I was saying. You have to ask questions and want to hear the answer.
Yeah, genuinely.
And so if he says that, ask him some questions. Why do you think it's polytheistic? How do you understand it as being polytheistic?
Adam, I have to leave, but have you read this book?
Awesome.
No.
Okay, take it home. You read it. Have your son read it. Trust me. It'll be a big help. Remember that one, Voyage to the Rock Father?
Oh, yeah, that's a nice book.
Yes, I think that'll be helpful for him.
Thank you.
God bless you all.
So that's what I would be curious about, is learning more about how he understands. If a Muslim comes up to you and says, says that, what is it about it that makes you believe it's polytheistic? Like, explain your understanding there. You really need to know more about that person to have that conversation. And that's
you don't want to stand there and say nothing because you can ask questions. Keep repeating that Christianity is polytheistic.
Right. So, is asking a question saying nothing?
No.
No.
Is it did?
So, for example, sometimes we feel this responsibility to defend the faith with statements. Right? And some of you went through the training know this story. So when Jesus was asked, by what authority do you do these things, did he respond with a statement in defense? Or did he ask a question? By what authority did John the Baptist do those things? So he defended the faith with a question. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, he did
that
a lot.
He did a lot.
Yeah, he did.
And so that's the basis of the whole Becoming Truly Human ministry, is you don't need to make statements to express Orthodox Christianity. You don't need to. And that really, when we're dealing with these encounters, we need to be hearing more questions. And that's what God did. That's what Jesus did. Often. Lots of questions. 300. Huh?
Somebody counted.
No, he 300. Yeah, I was bored.
Somebody.
It was either talk to this person on the plane next to me, not doing that again, or count questions in the test. No, somebody. Yeah, somebody did count them.
You put that guy's name on the chair. I was like, on his ear.
Yeah. So, do we have any other thoughts? And if you need to leave, don't feel bad. I know Gina's waiting to go.
Can you send us a list?
What's that?
Can you send us a list of 20 questions to ask people?
20 questions to ask people.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I'll work on it.
I'm married to Ty, so people, when they meet me after meeting Ty, think that I can ask them questions like Ty does. I don't do that.
Okay.
And so I need somebody to tell me what questions to ask people.
But the question is supposed to be about that person.
I'll think about it.
Okay.
That's what we do in Becoming Truly Human. We learn how to ask questions. So that would be the only thing I would know how to do right away. We have three types of questions in Becoming Truly Human.
My wife skipped our first Becoming Truly Human session.
Whatever. You'll have the materials. You should let her see it.
Yeah. No,
that would help her out. The moderator workbook.
Yeah. And I think, the need to answer a question is pretty great. So when you get asked a question, you want to answer it.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's
kind of great. You know, especially if you're tired or something, it's like, just ask a question and let them talk.
Well, that's what I was going to say, too. There's an element to whenever we're talking with other people and they ask us a question that we don't know the answer to, there's an element. Especially
the spiritual. And you said ask the question. And so that, you know, oh, I know a lot of people in this town that are spiritual. And so I always, like, what do you mean by that?
Yeah.
You know, and all of a sudden it's like,
what does that look like in your life?
Describing basically being Orthodox.
Yeah.
Like, over, it happens all the time.
Yeah.
And I've been having a dialogue with one friend in particular, and she has said to me any number of times, I really need to come to your church and see what it's like. And I think that asking questions can really work there.
I did.
Come and see.
Why not?
One thing that I ran into when I was
I tell them they have to come blindfolded.
You can come, but you can't see.
Yeah. You're going to be blindfolded because we don't want you to know where you are.
Exactly. One thing I came across when I was reading about Orthodoxy as a Protestant was a defense of somebody who was saying, I don't have to defend the Orthodox faith because it's been defending itself for 2,000 years. Like, the answers are out there whether we know them or not. And I don't have to know all of them. Especially stepping into this. Of truth, but to articulate that truth. And I use that in my conversations now, like to calm myself, like, I don't have to defend everyone. The faith will defend itself. The spirit will take care of the church. I don't have to be the holy warrior, which is different from the way I was raised, where I had to have the answer to it.
Or I think, yeah, you don't have to be an expert in every
single thing. Which gives me a lot of confidence to go, you know what?
This is the best answer I have.
Yeah, you're never going to learn all the answers.
Yeah. I'm almost there, but...
Yeah. I was... meant you specifically.
Yeah, yeah. Oh,
you'll never
learn. Oh, everyone else here.
You'll be lucky if you learn just a handful.
Oh, yeah. We made you flashcards.
You did.
I use flashcards.
Yeah. I use flashcards.
Do we have any other thoughts? George?
Yeah, express it in a nice way, but I was told by a lot of people in my past that, you know, you're a Christian. You're supposed to turn the other cheek. Remember that? Because I'm a very outspoken guy. And I talk politics and religion. As a matter of fact, in my business in L.A., that's what I used to start the tour with. Folks, I'm sorry. They told me not to talk religion. And that's how I start the tour with. So many times, really, I had people that, I love all the Christians, and I say that. I love the Baptists, I love the Catholics, I love all of them, that they name the Lord as their God, Jesus Christ. To me, they're all brothers, so I tell them so. But I happen to be an Orthodox. That will never change. Willing. But when the people come and tell me to hit me below the belt, I say, well, you're a Christian. You're supposed to turn the other cheek. So you know what I said to some of them? I said, you know what? This soul, this body, this heart belongs to Jesus. I want to protect his property. That's what I do. So you're not going to touch me. You touch me, I'm going to punch you back. So this is my answer to this. And I know this is not the proper Christian way to do it.
It's a little more confusing than that, actually. I don't. There's a scripture, I don't have to top of my head right now, where Jesus says, how many swords do we have? And I think Peter says, we have a few. He goes, okay, that's enough. Why did they want swords? Do you know what I'm talking about, Father?
Yeah,
that's it's a weird passage.
It's a head scratcher.
It's a real head scratcher.
So
Jesus had them carry swords.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to defend ourselves.
Was it Matthew?
I can't remember.
I'm not. Now, he also told Peter to stop cutting people's ears off.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
No more ears. We're not cutting ears off anymore. But you know, what I'm saying is, it's not that simple.
Yeah.
It's not that. I agree with you that it's not that simple.
Well, the faith is very complicated. I don't have to tell you. You know that, all of you. But it's also very simple. Just love God. Simple. I love Him. That's it. And I know He loves me too. No matter what happens. No matter what happens. So, but I don't have, I do talk to people like this, and I just have a lot of problems with what happens nowadays in the world. Christians being martyred and killed left and right all over the world. This is 2017, folks. I mean, this is not, what is this? So, please forgive me, but I asked one person, I said, when was the last time that you had heard that the devil worshiped God? God, may God forgive me, was cutting heads off to people of different faith. When was the last time? I'm not protecting the evil guy. God knows that, because I love Jesus. But I'm saying, is that bad that we're being killed as Christians all over the world? We should step in somehow and do something about that.
It is that bad.
It's awful. It's terrible.
Yeah.
You know, the Pope, God bless him, I have nothing against him. He goes there to criticize America, criticize this and do that, and yet he doesn't say anything about the same Catholics or other Christians being killed on a daily basis, folks, because the papers don't tell you that.
Yeah.
Like I told the guy from Social Security one time, I said, you know, I know a few things that you don't know and other people don't know. I'm not going to explain why. He said, well, you don't believe everything you read. I said, let me tell you something, young man. I believe more than I read, and I read between the lines. And I know a little bit more than that. So it's very complex circumstances in everything that we are encountering, especially today.
It is.
And he said, we are advanced. We are sophisticated. We are so-and-so. I said, really? We are dying like flies from cancer today, all over. And we said that we have the biggest, the best medicine, the best. It's not true. It's all not true. But we're not going to get involved in other things. But see, this is all involved with the religion, with beliefs. And that's why I tell people, just believe simple. Just love God, and He will love you back. And He loves you. Even if you don't love Him, He loves you. I'm not preaching to you. God forbid. You know what I mean?
It's okay.
I was supposed to be one. I said no to two bishops, one in Paris, France, and two here in Detroit and Los Angeles. You know what I mean? I said no for whatever reason. And I have my reason why I have said the wrong things, and I'm sure God was laughing when I said it. And
I think God laughs at me often.
He told me.
Thank you, George. Yeah. Kenny, did you have
something? Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Sorry.
So I have two questions. How would you encourage, or how can we embolden or encourage the parishioners in our church that do not care about evangelism? Not just avoid it, but the don't caring one. You talked about a little bit, but how do we as parishioners encourage our other parishioners? And the second question being, how would you answer the question of why should I become Orthodox/Christian?
So on the first one, I would say that you need to fall in love more often. And then you need to share that with those people in your parish. And as they begin to fall in love, they'll want to tell people. Because you taught them that's the model. And so, for example, I talked about this earlier, but let's say you fall in love with confession. And you have somebody that's not going to confession. That just really seems kind of, I'm not saying you know they never go, but it just really doesn't seem like they're ever going to confession. And you just talking about how much you've fallen in love with confession. And you're talking about you in confession, right? Just to give an example. And then it piques their curiosity. And you talk about how this is not something that you've arrived on your own. Confession was given to you by the church. It's not like you're you figured it out. You know, it's not like you figured out the answer and you're trying to help this person who doesn't have the answer. You fell in love with something. And you're like, I fell in love with it, and I want everyone to fall in love with it, because it's amazing how much, you know, how much it helps me as a person. And so it's those little areas that will daisy chain out. Does that make sense? And so it may not be evangelism right out of the gate. It might be love of Scripture. You know, like, I know people who love the Orthodox faith, and they're like, I can't read the Bible, it's boring. I can't do it. And then I tell them something they don't know from the Bible, and they're like, that's in the Bible? I'm like, yeah. And they're like, what's that?
Unicorns.
There's unicorns in the Bible. And so what I'm saying is, you have to fall in love on a regular basis, make that love contagious, and find little ways that starts to pull them into that 20%. And that what will be part of that is them understanding that now that they're in love, they should want to share that with people that are not. That's my current method, basically, is that when I was with a group of people from my church Thursday night, they were like, what are you doing these days? And I told them what I was falling in love with in terms of the church. And it was a very, and I was a little nervous because these guys don't really talk this way. So I talked about confession because I'm in the middle of falling in love with confession again. And one of the guys just jumped right in. He was like, oh, I know exactly what you're talking about. And all it took was two of us, and then they all joined in. And we all grew a little closer to God that night, and a little closer to evangelism, and now it's something we can talk about. And we talked about it with two people there who weren't Orthodox, and they got intrigued. Like, how could you want that? How could you want to go in front of another, the priest, and confess your sins? I'm like, I want to do it. The church isn't making me. I want to do it. And so that was evangelistic. That became evangelistic. So there has to be those things. You have to fall in love with Vespers and get more people at Vespers and understand that Vespers opens with creation. That's the song that's being read. We're entering into creation, and that's what's happening. And when you fall in love with Great Vespers on Saturday night and how it transforms Sunday morning, if I miss Vespers, I feel really out of sorts on Sunday morning. When I tell people that, they're like, what? Like, I'm serious. I almost feel like I can't take communion. Like, it's just, something's off. Something's incomplete in me. And when I share that with people that are not going to Vespers, they're now interested. And so it's these little ways that I feel like they're going to get interested. Until they're really in love with the faith, we can't really talk about evangelism. Once they're in love with the faith, then we can talk about, like, my friend Michelle, who was committed, Orthodox on purpose, all in. But evangelism for her was like this other thing that some people do. So then it just took one conversation. That was it. One conversation. Once she was all in, I just said, no, evangelism is just how you treat people in your daily lives. How you interact with people at church that you don't like. And then she was all on board. It was like so easy. That was the easy part, was getting her on board with evangelism. The hard part is getting people wanting to be at Vespers, wanting to be at Orthros, wanting to go to confession, wanting to volunteer at things that they don't want to volunteer at, right? That's the hard part. And once they're in love, then the evangelism kind of becomes easy.
Before you answer his second question, that just reminded me of several years ago. I don't remember at what point in the service, maybe right after liturgy, and I think it was Father John would have people stand up and like share their conversion story, maybe. But maybe that's something we could think about too. Is just a lot of us are involved in each other's lives, or we see each other a lot, and we don't necessarily see all the other people that maybe don't care about evangelism or whatever, but maybe a 5-minute sharing time once a month by one person saying, here's what I'm falling in love with, or not just an announcement, but like a real relational sharing from your heart with the parish as a whole. Here's what God has been transformed. Here's how God has been transforming me using St. George.
I think it's wonderful.
Yeah, so that's just, it just reminded me. I think that thing I was talking about before was separate. I mean, I remember like the pilgrims doing it, and the Winters, they would share their story about how they became Orthodox. It was right when we first started coming here. But that might be kind of a cool way to connect with our fellow parishioners that's not intimidating or awkward, but it's...
Yeah. I thought about that before, too.
Could you ever ask the kissing?
In terms of, especially with, like what you were talking about as far as Vespers and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And then it's just having people that actually come to those services talk about why.
Mm-hmm. Why I care about this.
Yeah.
Why I care about the Becoming Truly Human Women's Group. Why I care about...
Because when they hear me say it, it just registers as, oh, you're supposed to say that.
Mm-hmm. And he is.
Yeah,
but he also means it.
Yeah, I guess maybe us sharing things that we're passionate about, that can be contagious. And I think that's what it is, like with your guys and talking about confession, like it is contagious. When you see your family get excited about something, you want a piece of that.
You know, I did that with my kid just the other night on the way to Vespers. August is very excited about being in the altar. Like literally he said on Wednesday, he goes, Dad, can we have church every day between now and Sunday so I have practice for Sunday? But then he gave us an opportunity to talk about like how much I love being at Vespers and how much life it brings to me and just that evangelism with my own son and sharing in that joy that I've been sharing with him. You know, before that, you know, we talk about that regularly, and it's like starting to sink in that this is something we want to do. You know, I was talking about how what a great family time praying together is for me. Like in my chaotic life, like that's such a beautiful dedicated time to be with my family doing something, you know, submitting to God and whatnot, and sharing that love with him. I guess makes me feel like that's the testimony I give him is what I love.
Yeah. So it's falling in love with different things about the Orthodox faith and tell people about how you fell in love. Mm-hmm. And when you really did fall in love, it's going to be contagious. They're going to want to know more about why you fell in love with Vespers or confession.
It's not a convincing. I don't think telling somebody a story of your love story is not saying, here's the 4 points of why you should agree with me.
Right. Say you fall in love with the Book of Romans. Like, I never really sat down and read the Book of Romans. I read it, and I was like, wow. You know, I might be in the Book of Romans for the next 6 months. Because it's... You know what I'm saying? Like... So, I mean, we have to be falling in love all the time, I think. Because we get out of... I mean, Father said this. We get out of habit. You know that marriage is a work of love over and over. Like, you have to fall in love over and over and over and over in a way. Not like the fall in love like glitzy feelings. That's not what I mean. But I work at, you know, falling in love with my wife over and over and over. And so I do that with Orthodox things as well. So, like, a couple of years ago, like, I get a little excited like a schoolboy during Orthros when we sing, I don't remember what the part's called, Blessed Are You, Lord, Teach Me Your Statutes. Mm-hmm. And I just go so excited when that part comes out. Yeah. I'm like, yes, I love this part. You know? And I was telling someone about it, and they're like, you got excited in Orthros? I'm like, yeah. Every time it comes around. And I can really, like, sink in that hymn. I don't know why. Something about that hymn just really gets me, and I'm all in at that point. No matter what was happening, when it comes up, I'm like, oh yeah, unicorns. Okay, I'm back in. Like, I was thinking about the unicorns, but now I'm all into the service. And so, but this will happen over and over and over. You'll hear a gospel passage that you'll fall in love with. I mean, at the beginning of April, I was at the Antiochian Village, our camp, for Archdiocese, and I was there for an early morning Orthros with everybody, and I was exhausted. I was just exhausted, and I'm waiting, and all of a sudden this one hymn comes up that I felt like I'd never heard before, and I took someone's paper. I was like, can I have that? Thanks. And I'm reading the hymn, and I was like, wow. ripped it out and I put it in my pocket and took it home and put it up on my wall. And I stared at it for days. And I looked at it and I said, I'm not sure I could ever be depressed and read this at the same time. And I fell in love with it. That's what I mean. Like, and when I tell people that story, how are they not going to be interested? I want to read it. I'm like, well, it may not have the same effect, but it's all here waiting on you. It's waiting on you to fall in love, for you to fall in love with it. So you had a second question.
Just a general question. If someone asked you why I should be a Christian or Orthodox.
Why should I be an Orthodox Christian? Ooh. You get to be right and tell everyone else they're wrong.
Yeah, it's just so good.
It's amazing. It feels so good.
I don't know if it's true, but
it feels so good. We drink a lot.
Yes, really. Yeah.
That's a hard one to respond to without knowing who the person is, because there's a lot of. I can tell you the different directions I might go. Does that help?
You're talking to me before I was a Christian.
Before you're a Christian. It's still hypothetical, but I would really want to know more about.
Maybe this isn't for you.
Yeah, I would want to know more about. I would want to know your background.
I figured you would.
I would want to know how you were raised. I would want to know. Every person I've met that left Christianity left over a painful experience. Every person. And if you're not a Christian, you were probably raised in a semi-Christian household in America. Probably at this point in our demographics. Mm-hmm. And so I would want to see what it would take to find out what that painful event. And that really what happens is that painful event now becomes the lens through which you look at all of Christianity and all of life, in a way. And so until you get back to that event, you never really... I mean, I know people that are in the Orthodox Church, but they're still not...
Why should your sister be Christian?
Huh?
Why should your sister-in-law be Christian?
Why is she not?
Why should she be?
Why should she be? She would say she is. She disagrees with some theology of the Orthodox Church. She believes that we've twisted some things. And so, if she doesn't agree with history, we start to become at an impasse. If this is how I see history, and you disagree, we're now talking about two different things in a way that's really difficult to move forward. So that's why I would say we probably focus our conversation on general ideas. But when you have people, and there's a large number of them, I don't know if you know this, that believe that gay marriage used to be a thing of the church. But there's a ceremony.
Oh.
Right? And so she thinks that we changed that and got rid of it. And I say, that's not how I understand our history, but that's how she understands our history.
Well, that's similar to talking to Jehovah's Witness, talking about when we invented the Trinity. They've been taught that the history is that we invented the Trinity at the Council of Nicaea. That's not how we understand history.
Right, you see what I'm saying? So now you're dealing with two different interpretations of history, and it becomes a very difficult conversation when you have two different sources of credibility. So,
why would you say you are a Christian?
Why am I a Christian?
Yeah, like if someone say, well, why are you a Christian or why are you an Orthodox Christian? Do you have an answer? Like, do you have a... somewhat great answer for that?
Do I have an answer of why I'm an Orthodox Christian? I believe that I was created by God in His image to have a relationship with Him. And I believe that He revealed Himself in the form of Jesus Christ. And if you want to get into logics, I actually got into logics a few years ago about the Bible. Is the Bible, what we're really talking about, is the New Testament believable? Is it just been translated so many times? You know, I've heard this from people. Well, you can't really trust any translations. They're not really accurate. And here's kind of how I look at it. It got real for me in a way that it had never gotten before in terms of, can I trust Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? Can I trust what they wrote? Right? And so I started to put myself in their shoes. And they're writing in a time that we can't fathom. But this is when I became even more of a Christian. This is when it became real. For the first 300 years, when you became a Christian, you knew that it could mean dying. You knew that. That was part of becoming a Christian. And that you knew you could be tortured, that you were going to be persecuted, that your family would go under the same thing for 300 years. So what would cause a group of people who, they're not going to die for a lie. You don't die for a lie if you think something's not true, right? So all of Jesus' followers die a martyr's death. They're killed, except for John. Okay? So they're being put to death unless they tell the truth. They're not getting money. They're not rich for being Christians and believing in Jesus. These are 12 men, including Paul, right? They're not getting women, which does influence certain men of power to get whatever women you want. They're not getting power. They have no control over anything. They're being killed. So they have no money, no women, no power, no glory. And they're willing to die to deliver this message. And they did that for 300 years. And then I wondered, am I really a Christian? Would I die to deliver this message? And up to that point, I had never really taken it seriously, what they went through to deliver the message. And I'm a Christian because I believe they died to get the truth to me. I believe them. Because when I think about all the different things that you could be tortured for and killed for, would I, if they had, let's go through that crazy scenario. Christ really died, He didn't rise from the dead, and they just wanted to carry it on. What was in it for them? Nothing. There was nothing in it for them. Every scenario that I look at points to that. This was so important that they died to get it to me. That's why I'm a Christian. What about you guys? Do you have any? Why are you a Christian? Because that's what I tell someone if they ask me. I had to think about it because I haven't thought about it in the last few months. But at Christmas I was thinking about it because I was trying to figure out how to communicate it with my son. And he wasn't quite ready at Christmas, but I think he's ready now to talk about it.
I think a lot of it for me is recognizing my illness and looking for a doctor to heal it.
Yeah.
And looking around and not finding good medicine for a while, and then you find something that actually brings some healing that might seem miraculous. you actually not feel better, but know that health is appearing in places that health was not before. So to be healed.
I kind of feel like Ty does. I mean, when you're deep in despair and you don't have anything else out there, who do you turn to?
Yes.
You know? I mean, people that don't believe in God or some form of whatever they're, who do they turn to? It's just nice to know that there's places to go, things to read, icons to see, and people that listen that know that you need help.
Mm-hmm. Well, from I think the Orthodox, to expand it to Orthodox, I think coming here has been not just healing, but interacting with something on a deeper real level, like walking into something that is a little bit more like heaven. In some kind of mystical way that I can't put my finger on. The reason that I don't fall asleep during Orthodox services, and I always fell asleep, even as a pastor, I would fall asleep in the front row. And so did Metropolitan Plus swear while he was talking.
I've not gotten that bad yet.
That's a great story.
But I think that there's something that draws me in a way that it never drew me in before. Something, I think it's tapping into something a little bit more real. You know, it's kind of like the Great Divorce that C.S. Lewis talks about. Like, I feel like it hurts a little bit, and I started realizing that pain actually gave me a flavor of something more real.
Yeah. Yeah.
This might be a good stopping point, unless you guys want to keep talking.
I gotta go.
But it's three, and I think we said three.
Yeah, we did.
So.
Thank you, Adam.
Thank you.
Thank you.